Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Welcome to worship at Mount Calvary, and what an exciting day this is. Really exciting for a number of reasons. We have a smattering of guests here. Welcome. Glad that you are here. We have some old friends who are here for a wedding. We have a baptism, and we're going to welcome new members. And above all, we have the Word of Christ that offers us rest. I'm guessing that there are one or two of you who, through May activities, come here a little bit weary, and maybe you're weary of carrying around the burden of guilt and sin. Here we are to hear the word of Jesus, who promises us rest in him. That's the focus of our service today. The beginning of the service will be a baptism hymn, and right, let's worship the Lord. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Our Savior Jesus Christ commanded baptism when he said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit." All of us are born into this world with a deep need for baptism. From our parents, we inherit a sinful nature. We are without true fear of God and true faith in God, and are condemned to eternal death. But Jesus took away our sin by giving his life on the cross. At our baptisms, he clothes us with the robe of his righteousness and gives us a new life. Our sinful nature need not control us any longer. We recall what baptism means for our daily lives as we speak these words. Baptism means that the sinful nature in us should be drowned by daily sorrow and repentance, and that all its evil deeds and desires be put to death. It also means that a new person should daily arise to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. As baptized children of God, we confess our sins. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful, and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this, I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, and united us to the death and resurrection of Jesus. Every day, God forgives your sins, removes your guilt, and strengthens you to defeat Satan's power. His promise is for you and your children, and he will never forsake you. Your sins are forgiven. You are clothed with Christ. You are at peace with God now and forever. Amen. The Gospel according to St. Mark. People were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them. Please be seated. Okay, who's first? Us. All right, come on forward. Yep. Should I do Augustus?
Sure.
All right. Augustus. Oh, I'm sorry. Getting confused. Gus. August Spader. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Millie Spader. I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Sophie Spader, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. There you go. Good one, Bob. I forgot to give you one. There you go. Okay. Gustav Spader, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Cassandra Spader, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Receive the sign of the cross from the head to the heart to mark you as redeemed children of God. Redeemed by Christ the Crucified. The Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ has given you the new birth of water and the Spirit and has forgiven all your sins. May he strengthen you with his grace all the days of your life. Peace be with you. Let us pray. Merciful Father in heaven, we thank you for the gift of baptism by which you wash away sin and give us new and eternal life. Help us each day to remember that through baptism you clothe us with Christ, that we may stand holy and righteous before you. Look with favor on the Spader family, that they may be kept safe by the gift of your Spirit, grow daily in your grace, and live forever by the power of the risen Christ. Make us willing to carry out our responsibilities to all the baptized, so that all may finally come to the blessed joys of heaven, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Jesus said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." As this candle is lit, be reminded of the connection that you have to Jesus, who is the light of the world and the light of your lives. And you're encouraged on the anniversary of your baptism to take out that candle and to light it and to remember your baptismal grace. Peace be with you. Here, Gus, you want to take that? The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal God, your Son, Jesus Christ, is our true Sabbath rest. Help us to keep each day holy by receiving his word of comfort, that we may find our rest in him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. First reading from God's word is recorded in the Old Testament in book of Deuteronomy chapter 5. As part of his commandments to his people, Israel, was this: remember the Sabbath day, not simply by thinking about it, but by doing nothing, in a sense, resting from the regular labors of the week and gathering together to hear the word and promise of God, reminded of the covenant relationship they had with him. Jesus has come as the fulfillment of that promise to be the true Sabbath rest for God's people. Observe the Sabbath day by keeping it holy, as the Lord your God has commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your ox, your donkey, or any of your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns, so that your male and female servants may rest, as you do. Remember that you were slaves in Egypt, and that the Lord your God brought you out of there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God has commanded you to observe the Sabbath day. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
second reading from God's word is recorded in Paul's letter to the Colossians, chapter 2, verses 13 through 17. In this letter, the apostle Paul reminds God's people that they have true rest in Jesus, who has freed us from the curse of sin, who has granted us new and lasting life. And so he says that those things that were a shadow of his coming, like the Sabbath day, need not bind us, but he directs us to find our rest always and only and every day in Christ. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. Therefore, do not let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. Alleluia, the commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. Alleluia. The Holy Gospel is recorded in Mark chapter 2, beginning with verse 23. One Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as his disciples walked along, they began to pick some heads of grain. The Pharisees said to him, "Look, why are they doing what is unlawful on the Sabbath?" He answered, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need? In the days of Abiathar, the high priest, he entered the house of God and ate the consecrated bread, which is lawful only for priests to eat. And he also gave some to his companions." Then he said to them, "The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. So the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Another time, Jesus went into the synagogue, and a man with a shriveled hand was there. Some of them were looking for a reason to accuse Jesus, so they watched him closely to see if he would heal him on the Sabbath. Jesus said to the man with the shriveled hand, "Stand up in front of everyone." Then Jesus asked them, "Which is lawful on the Sabbath, to do good or to do evil, to save life or to kill?" But they remained silent. He looked around at them in anger and, deeply distressed at their stubborn hearts, said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out, and his hand was completely restored. Then the Pharisees went out and began to plot with the Herodians how they might kill Jesus. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. Please be seated.
God's richest grace and mercy and peace are showered upon you each and every day. Because you have been given rest in the one whom we confess and know to be God and Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior. And we hear our God proclaim these words to us this morning through the Apostle Paul in Colossians, where we hear this: when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature, God made you alive with Christ. Requiescat in pace. That's a Latin phrase that actually you know very well. Literally translated, it means this. It means, may the deceased person rest in peace. Now, all of us know that Latin phrase by these three letters, R-I-P. And for centuries, those three letters, R-I-P, can be found on tombstones. Rest in peace. And it's because of these three letters that we can find on tombstones is the reason that we have come to believe that death brings rest and peace. Now, I will grant you that when we die, when we're 8 feet under, I suppose we could say there is some rest with that. For we're no longer having to endure the stress of our day-to-day lives. The worries of this life are done and over. That's all true enough. But what is even more true is that death can be anything but peaceful and restful. In fact, death could usher in the start of untold restlessness and peacelessness as someone faces the reality of what life is really like without God. Death is not at all restful. Death is not at all peaceful. Which is why, if you want to put some letters on your tombstone, I'm going to suggest these letters this morning. R-I-C. Now, I think you can probably guess what the first two letters, huh? Rest in Christ. Rest in Christ. And today we're going to hear Paul say without apology and with absolute conviction, proclaim this truth, R-I-C, rest in Christ. And Paul speaks of R-I-C in this way. He says, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your sinful nature. When you were dead in your sins. Look at what Paul does here. He equates sin with being dead. And you know what? We do the same thing. For how many of you have ever heard these three words? You're so dead. I can tell you who's probably heard those words before. The husband out playing golf with his buddy on the golf course when he's really concentrating on his swing, and all of a sudden he remembers, I forgot my anniversary. And then you know what all of his buddies on the golf course say to him? You're so dead. One sibling says to another, who just put a big dent in Dad's new car, "You're so dead. Dad's gonna kill you." Why do we say that? Why is it that when immediately we do something wrong, we equate doing something wrong with death? You want to know who else does the same thing? Our God. When you were dead in your sins. When you were dead in your sins. So the point is this: death and rest and peace, these words are not words that mesh and go together. The question then becomes is, how do we try and avoid this state of deadness? Well, think of the husband. The husband there may drop everything right there on the golf course and then scramble to try to find a way to get himself out of the mess that he is in, to make up for his forgetfulness. But does scramble mode bring rest? The child who put a dent or a scratch in Dad's new car may try to maybe pound out that dent himself, or maybe go, you know, and try to rub out that scratch, hoping that Dad is just going to not see it and it's going to go completely unnoticed, and that maybe a month later, you know, down the road, Dad finally sees this dent and scratch and say, "Anybody know how God got there?" "I have no idea." But how much rest has that strategy brought you in your life, trying to take care of it or hide what you've done wrong before Dad gets home? This is what we do when we know that we are so dead. We try to make up for what we have done, or we try to hide it, or we try to take care of it on our own to avoid death. Therefore, when it comes to God saying that we are dead in our sins, it should come as no surprise to any of us that we try to do the same thing with our God to avoid deadness. We try to make up for it, hoping to avoid death. Or maybe, you know, we just try to ignore it, hoping that God is just going to overlook it. Maybe God will ignore it too. "I can take care of this myself, no problem. I don't need God." But doing things to try to avoid death, trying to hide or ignore death, that doesn't bring rest. It's just wishful thinking when left up to us. But our God doesn't use death to bring us rest and peace. Instead, he gives us the opposite of death, doesn't he? And what's the opposite of death? That's life. And so you see, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave all our sins, having canceled the written code that, with its regulations, that was against us and that stood opposed to us. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. So what's God's solution in order to have rest? R-I-C. Rest in Christ. God has made us alive, not dead, but alive with Christ. God has literally erased our record of debt. And since there is no record at all of any of us doing anything wrong, there's no reason for anyone to come up to us and say, "You are so dead." We don't have to worry about death because God has made us alive in Christ. Think when the last time it was you did something wrong. A big one. You might think, boy, if only this hadn't have happened, how could I have done this? Oh, how I wish this never took place. We say this to ourselves when we are afraid and we realize that we are so dead. But with our God, this is exactly what happens. He erases that debt of ours. It's like it was never there. And therefore, there is no reason to die. How did God do this? R-I-C. He took it away, nailing it to the cross. In Christ, God erased our legal indebtedness. He erased our debt of death. In Christ at the cross is where our peace is found. We don't need to go into scramble mode. We don't need to go and try and hide. There's nothing for us to try and fix. There's only rest. Because God has made us alive with Christ, who erased our debt. How? He took it away, nailing it to the cross. Never again do we ever have to worry about someone coming to up to us and proclaiming, "We are so dead," because God has made us alive in Christ. He disarmed the powers and authorities. He made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross. When this world and our great enemy and our own mind wants to proclaim to us that we are so dead, we can simply point to the cross and say, "I am not so dead. I am alive with Christ." Your power and authority to pronounce death on me ended at the cross. R-I-C. I rest in Christ. And since there is only R-I-C, we enjoy an extended rest. Just listen. Therefore, as a result of taking it away, nailing it to the cross, therefore, don't let anyone judge you by what you eat or drink, or with regard to a religious festival, a new moon celebration, or a Sabbath day. Why? Don't let anyone judge you? Because R-I-C, not R-I-A. Rest in action. Therefore, don't let anyone tell you that somehow you can have rest with God by what you do, by what you eat or drink. that can affect your relationship with your God, because it can't. Don't let anyone convince you that if you want to avoid death, if you really want to have rest with God, well then, you know, there's really only one proper day to worship on, and that's on Sunday. Saturday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, just as good as Sunday. One day isn't any better than another, because rest doesn't come in eating and drinking certain things. It doesn't come in attending worship on certain days. Your rest doesn't come in death, but in R-I-C. Nor is rest R-I-T. Rest in tradition. Styles of worship, form of worship, time of worship does not provide rest. Going through the motion of attending worship on Christmas and Easter, or on any holiday, or on any Sunday, does not provide rest. And here's why. These are a shadow of the things that were to come. The reality, however, is found in Christ. Before our Savior gave us rest by having himself nailed to a tree, it's true that God's people were only allowed to eat certain things. And they had to rest and then to worship on a certain day, on Saturday. Why? Why did God, you know, stipulate to his Old Testament people, you were to avoid eating certain things, you could only worship on Saturday? It's because, not because it merited them any rest, but rather the rest of the Sabbath, and Sabbath means rest, and all those religious festivals that the Lord told his people to do, it all pointed to the body who was making the shadow that would provide rest. Because the reality, however, is found in Christ. R-I-C. Therefore, you have rest. You have rest from anyone declaring to you, you're so dead. You're not dead, you're alive with Christ. You have rest from trying to provide yourself with rest by working to keep all of the laws and regulations that have been written down, because all of these laws and regulations have already been kept for you by Christ. And that was something that the Pharisees just couldn't get through their thick skulls, as we saw in the gospel, as one day they saw Jesus' disciples there in the grain fields picking the heads of the grain and eating it. And the Pharisees are saying, boy, you guys are so dead. You're so dead because look at what you're doing. And if you really want to have rest with God, you shouldn't be doing that, because it's dependent on you not doing certain things. And then they even got more upset with Jesus himself when one Sabbath, that man with the shriveled hand, when he healed that man with a shriveled hand. Jesus, you're not resting. You're doing something. God's not going to be happy with you. So what does Jesus say? The Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath. The reality of the rest of the Sabbath day is found in the one whom we call the Christ. Requiescat in pace. The Apostle Paul reminded us today why we can rest in peace when we are 8 feet under. Not because death has freed us from all of the stress and work and responsibilities and worries of this world. We rest in peace because of the body of Christ, who cast his shadow on the Sabbath day and provided the rest the Sabbath day pointed to by taking our debt with him all the way to the cross. Today and always, R-I-C, rest in Christ. Amen. Please rise. Now may that peace and rest that you have in your Savior from sin continue to comfort you and give you peace as you wait for him. We join together now in confessing our faith, and we do so using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated for prayer.
Power belongs to you, O God, and with you is unfailing love. You are our unshakable rock and fortress. Truly our souls find rest in you, O God. Our salvation comes from you. You have given us Jesus to give us the true Sabbath rest. Turn our hearts to him whenever we are weary and burdened, and give us rest with the peace of his forgiveness. Human hearts are restless until they rest in you. Send your gospel to people near and far who have not heard it, that they may know the peace of your forgiveness and the comfort of your mercy and love. We give thanks for the teachers and proclaimers of your word. Let the truths of your word be known, that people will know their sin and find rest in their Savior. Give all your messengers boldness and confidence as they bring your peace to others. Give your rest to those who are afflicted in mind or body. Lift their burdens with your forgiveness and pardon. Give them confidence in your word and promise. Hold out the promise of the eternal Sabbath in your presence. And Lord, we remember our brother and sister, Matt and Anna Lang, and their new baby, Maisie. We thank you for giving safety to Anna through the delivery, and we ask that you would continue to watch over parents and child. We look forward to the time when you will welcome Maisie into your kingdom through the sacrament of baptism. We commend parents and Maisie into your loving and gracious care. O Lord, give us peace, for you give us all things, the peace of rest and the peace of the eternal Sabbath, which has no ending. Rest in us then, as you work in us now, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The offerings of God's people will be brought forward, and at this time we ask that you sign the register, friendship register, and say hello to somebody in your bench. Would our new members please come forward? Well, you can look this way. That way you don't have to be embarrassed. Unless you want to look at them, you can. They would probably enjoy that, actually. But I'll talk to you first. Welcome. Friends in Christ, St. Paul described the unity that exists in Christ's church when he wrote, "There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of us all, who is over all and through all and in all. With sincere joy, we welcome you to the fellowship of our congregation. As you know, believers in Christ regularly gather around his word and sacraments, encourage one another in faith and life, and carry out the work of his kingdom. The scriptures encourage us. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. I ask you, is it your desire to join us in worship and mission and support this work with your prayers and gifts? If so, answer, it is, and I ask God to help me." Brothers and sisters of Mount Calvary, as we welcome these new members to our Christian family, I encourage you in the name of Jesus to keep them in your minds, hold them in your hearts, and pray for them again and again. Show them the face of friendship and offer them a hand of support. Encourage them with your works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature, attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. The peace of Christ be with us all. Amen. We pray. Gracious Father, we thank you for leading Timothy Geyer, Eric Graham, Christopher Melby, Russell Nielsen, Jonathan, Rihanna, and Holden Roscoff, Brian, Erica, Cole, and Logan Schmidt, Gustav, Cassandra, Millie, Sophie, and August Spader, David Swanson, Ben, Amanda, Ben Jr., and Elise White, to desire to become members of our congregation. Guide us with your wisdom as we worship and work together. Mold our minds and hearts into a single Christ-like will so that we may be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, and faithful in prayer. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. We'll join in the next song, and you may return to your seats. Welcome. Lord, when our sins overwhelm us, help us turn to you, who truly bore the weight of them all. Because you endured God's anger, assure us that the debt of our sin has been paid in full. Hear us because of your tender mercy, so that the devil dare not accuse us, but must flee in shame, for you live and rule with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. Good morning, everybody. Welcome, especially to our visitors and our new members. Each month, we watch the Wells Connection. If you can give us just a few minutes to do that, I'll have a few more announcements after.
Well, Sister Churches program that strives to prepare even more men across the continent for gospel ministry. We travel to the Philippines to meet one of those men.
Struggle? Have you asked this question before? Most of the time. Good morning, everyone. Good to see everybody here this morning and to welcome so many new members. Good to have you with us. So I'm Principal Brad Gergel, and I'm just reminding you all that today we're starting something new that we haven't done before over the summer. Today is our first family Bible hour. So whether you're 0 years old or 99 years old or anywhere in between, we'd love to have you stay and be part of that. Each week we're going to talk about a miracle of Jesus in a way that both is visual and easy for kids to understand, but also that adults can take away neat new facts and historical background to the stories that they probably didn't know before either. So we hope you can stay for that. There's refreshments in the first preschool room down this hallway, donuts, coffee, things like that, that we want you to enjoy for, you know, 10 or 15 minutes or so. And then we'll meet back here at 9:20 to learn about a miracle of Jesus, play some games. We got some Bible categories going on today in our groups of families. We've got trading cards on the miracles of Jesus that if you collect those each week and bring them back the last week, there'll be prizes and other things that you can earn with that. So families, kids, adults, young and old, we'd love to have you stay and be part of that starting today and then each week all summer between the services as we learn about the miracles of Jesus. So we hope you can stay for refreshments and that afterwards. God's blessings on your Sunday.